here comes Jackie waving by. And Mr. Kennedy. President's car is now turning onto Elm Street, and it will be only a matter of minutes before he arrives at the trademark. It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route. There's numerous people running up the hill alongside Elm Street. Stand by just a moment, please. Put me on, Phil. Put me on. The motorcade is coming by here. The presidential car coming up now. We know it's the presidential car. You see Mrs. Kennedy's pink suit. There's a Secret Service man, spread eagle, over the top of the car. We understand Governor and Mrs. Connolly are in the car with President and Mrs. Kennedy. We can't see who has been hit, if anybody has been hit, but apparently something is wrong here. Something is terribly wrong. I'm in behind the motorcade, trying to follow them. It looks as though they're going to Parkland Hospital. And just now, we've received reports here at Parkland that Governor Connolly was shot in the upper left chest, and the first unconfirmed reports say the president was hit in the head. That's an unconfirmed report that the president was hit in the head.
A priest has been ordered. Emergency supplies of blood also being rushed to the hospital.
Just a moment. Just a moment. We have a bulletin coming in. We now switch you directly to Parkland Hospital and KBOX News Director Bill Hampton.
The president of the United States is dead. It's official. As of just a few moments ago, the president of the United States.
Arlington National Cemetery, Washington, and the final resting place of one of America's greatest heroes. Each year, 3.5 million people pay homage at this shrine to the memory of President John F. Kennedy. They also come to ponder one of the greatest murder mysteries of all time.
There was a monstrous cover-up of everything. I know it, and so do the people who covered it up.
It angers me terribly that we don't know the truth, and the arrogance of those in power that continue the cover-up and the lie is beyond tolerance.
We're not a free country anymore, because the people who are smart enough and powerful enough to take out a president like that and get away with it for 25 years are probably involved in other areas of the government. In other words, the country is being run by people we did not vote for.
If it could be done to John F. Kennedy in 1963, it could be done to another president in the future. And we can't afford to have coup d'etats in America, no matter how cleverly orchestrated and sinisterly contrived they may be. That cannot be permitted to happen. And the way in which you prevent that from happening is to expose those elements of government and society in this country that were responsible for the killing of John F. Kennedy.
The southeast corner window of the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository, Dallas. According to the official verdict, the spot where a lone gunman, Lee Harvey Oswald, fired 3 shots into Dealey Plaza, striking the president from behind as he rode in a motorcade down the center of Elm Street. And each year on November the 22nd, an informal gathering on the grassy knoll of people skeptical of their government's conclusion.
In honor of the events that took place here in November 1963. One moment, please.
Until now, the world has been asked to accept the Warren Commission's verdict on the death of John F. Kennedy. New evidence that exposes the complex and sinister forces that brutally murdered the President of the United States 25 years ago will be shown here for the first time. President Kennedy's last day began at a Chamber of Commerce breakfast in Fort Worth. In his entourage were Vice President Lyndon Johnson and the Governor of Texas, John Connally.
Basically, his purpose for his visit to Texas, it was not just to Dallas, was to raise money for himself and for the Democratic Party, and also to enhance his standing, because he was looking forward to the election in 1964.
Couldn't let you leave Fort Worth without providing you with some protection against the rain.
Of on in the White House on Monday. If you'll come up there, you'll have a chance to see it then.
His second engagement of the day was a luncheon in Dallas, a six-minute flight away on Air Force One.
And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and give you peace both now and forever.
From the dark, overcast, the drizzling rain of Fort Worth to the bright sunshine when we landed at Love Field in Dallas, it promised to be an absolutely spectacular day for the president, for the vice president, for me. I was governor of the state. Ms. Connolly and I rode in the car with President and Mrs. Kennedy. He got a very, very warm reception. Schools had turned out. The school children were lining the street. By the thousands. They were applauding, and it was a very happy, joyful occasion, really.
Two cars back from the presidential limousine was Senator Ralph Yarborough with Lyndon and Lady Bird Johnson.
As we approached the city and then finally turned down Main Street toward the Trinity River, the crowd increased as we got to the heart of Dallas. And it was one of the most enthusiastic crowds I saw in any city we were in Texas on that tour. That's on the sidewalks. Now, if you looked up in the upper stories, I never saw a single smile any window I looked at. Some looked down and looked like with dislike on the faces. Nellie turned to the president and said, "Now, Mr. President, you can't say now that they don't love you here in Dallas." And within a matter of a few seconds after that, we turned on Elm Street to go down to get on the Stimmons Freeway to go out to the Trade Mart where the luncheon was being held. And that's when the shots occurred. I heard what I thought was a rifle shot. I immediately reacted by turning to look over my right shoulder because that's where the sound came from. I didn't see anything out of the ordinary and was in the process of turning to look over my left shoulder when I felt a blow in the middle of my back, as if someone had hit me with a doubled-up fist, about like that. The blow was of such force that it bent me over, and I immediately saw that I was covered with blood. And I knew I'd been hit. And I said, "Oh my God, they're gonna kill us all." And I heard another shot that was a loud shot almost like that, and immediately, I saw blood and brain tissue all over the back of the limousine. I knew then that the president had been fatally hit because Ms. Kennedy then, I heard her say, "My God, I've got his brains in my hand."
To this day, the gruesomeness of Kennedy's killing haunts those who are closest to the president. Riding a few feet from the limousine was Dallas Police outrider Bobby Hargis.
There's another motorcycle officer by the name of Buddy Brewer that came up to me and said, "Bob, you have something on your lip." And he tucked his finger like that, and it was a piece of the president's brain and a piece of his skull bone that had hit me on the lip. The watery blood and stuff that came from his wound was splattered my motorcycle and all over my uniform and my helmet, my face, and all of us felt real bad. Every single soul in the police department felt bad.
The Secret Service in the car in front of us kind of casually looked around, looked up at the back of them, and rather slow to react, and it went under the underpass, and as we came up on the other side, I could see then the president's car, and there was Hill, whom I knew as a Secret Service man assigned to protect Mrs. Kennedy. He was lying across the back to hang on with arm over in there so he could hang on at that high speed. His face turned back towards us, just writhed in agony and beating with his hand on there like a terrible thing has happened. I knew then that Kennedy had been shot. And within several minutes, we came to Parkland Hospital, and the Secret Service immediately jumped out the minute Johnson was there. They practically pulled him out and formed a cordon around him, four or five, and one of them said, "Mr. President."
I knew then Kennedy was dead. And I walked up to the car where Mrs. Kennedy was still there on the back seat, lying there with her head bowed over, covering the husband's head, his blood running down her leg and by on her clothes, and twice saying, "They've murdered my husband. They've murdered my husband." It's the most tragic sight of my life.
While the senator wept for his president, inside Parkland Hospital, doctors battled to resuscitate him in trauma room one.
My most vivid impression of the entire agitated scene was that his head had been almost destroyed. The face was intact but very swollen, and it was obvious that he had had a massive wound to his head.
We decided that the president was dead, and Dr. Clark, the chairman of neurosurgery, had come in the meantime, and he had walked up to the head of the patient and looked inside at the wound and shook his head.
John F. Kennedy died at approximately 1 o'clock Central Standard Time today here in Dallas. He died of a gunshot wound in the brain. Dr. Berkeley told me it's a simple matter, Tom, of a bullet right through the head.
Outside Parkland Hospital, grief overcame the waiting crowd as the president's death was confirmed. The first to break the news was Senator Ralph Yarborough.
I knew he was dead. I'd been around enough violence in my life to know he was a dead man. And the press came up and asked me what had happened. So I said, "There's been a deed of horror. An ex-cobbler has sunk beneath the waves." I thought that would tell them, in effect, what had happened without my saying he was dead.
We made valiant and unceasing efforts to resuscitate this man who was mortally wounded. And I think had we taken the opposite attack and said, "Oh, this man is dead," that even today people would be questioning and telling us stories about mortally wounded people who had been resuscitated when all hope was lost. So instead of taking that approach, we took the approach, let's save this man if we can, and we made what would be commendable, I think, even by today's standards, efforts to resuscitate him.
State authorities wanted to do an autopsy, which is state law in the state of Texas, and the federal people wanted to take it back to Washington, D.C. And there was a lot of pushing, shoving, cursing. We would try to roll the casket out, someone would grab it and try to roll it back towards the trauma room. This went on for quite a while. It was push and shove type thing. Quite a bit of, obscene language.
I believe that if Dr. Rose had been allowed to perform the examination here, since his qualifications were impeccable, that much of the early confusion surrounding the wounds and the questions as to the direction and number of shots could have been settled quickly under the capable forensic studies which Dr. Rose would undoubtedly have performed. But we didn't have the opportunity to examine President Kennedy here.
At Parkland Hospital, the Secret Service had won the battle for the president's body. With unseemly haste, they illegally removed it from Dallas and flew it back to Andrews Air Force Base in Washington. The new president had been sworn in on the plane and now made his first address to the nation.
I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear.
But as Kennedy's coffin was unloaded into a hearse in full public view, it seems his body was surreptitiously being removed from the far side of Air Force One and taken away by helicopter.
I ask for your help and God.
Its most likely destination was Walter Reed Army Hospital for a covert examination of the president's wounds and the removal of his brain. This prevented a proper investigation of the fatal headshot at the official autopsy. Only a 5-minute flight from Walter Reed, the helicopter pad at Bethesda Naval Hospital, where the autopsy team awaited the arrival of Kennedy's body. Medical technician Paul O'Connor was there.
I remember it being about 8 o'clock in the evening that we heard helicopters. I heard helicopters. And it sounded to me like there were two helicopters. Couldn't tell where they were coming from or where they went, but it sounded like they were landing. A few few minutes later, a door burst open in the back of the hospital, and in came six or eight men carrying a casket. As I remember, this casket was a type of casket that was a cheap shipping type of casket. What I mean by a shipping casket is that it's not a very ornamental casket. It's not very expensive. It's a very plain casket.
This is not the casket in which Al Reich placed the president's body at Parkland Hospital, Dallas.
It was a expensive bronze color type. It was a bronze casket. One of the most expensive that we had in stock. It was a white satin lining inside the casket. We wrapped him in one of the sheets and just placed him in the casket that way.
The casket was opened, and inside was a slate-gray rubber body bag with a zipper that ran from the head all the way down to the toes. It's the kind of body bag that you find people that were carried out of a disaster in. We unzipped the body bag, and inside was the body of the president. We put the body on the table. He was nude, no clothes on, but he had a white sheet, bloody white sheet wrapped around his face and his head.
So between Parkland Hospital in Dallas and the autopsy in Washington, the president's body had mysteriously been placed in another casket and also wrapped differently. Since the autopsy, there's also been a major discrepancy in the description of the president's fatal head wound.
I can see that he had a large, about 7 centimeter opening in the right occipital parietal area. And considerable portion of the brain was missing there, and the occipital cortex, the back portion of the brain, was lying down near the opening of the wound, and blood was trickling out.
It would be a jagged wound that involved the half of the right side of the back of the head. My initial impression was that it probably was an exit wound, so it was a very large wound.
This is not what the official autopsy photographs show. Hidden away for a quarter of a century and shown here for the first time, they reveal the back of the head intact.
The autopsy photographs show a massive wound, but it's in the right temporal area and into the parietal area, which is behind it, between the two. It is inconceivable to me that every single one of the witnesses who saw the president's head could be wrong, and specifically wrong, about this particular wound. They describe an avulsed, exploded, open wound in the rear of the head. In the autopsy photographs, you see a small, neat wound of entrance. It's obvious to me that those photographs have been faked.
When I first saw the pictures of the president's body, so-called wounds, what really struck me was, especially the head wound, they showed a nice little neat round bullet hole in the back of his head. When actually what I saw was the whole side of his head blown off. It was gone. I don't know where those things came from, but they're totally wrong. Every one of them.
In 1964, the Warren Commission dealt with this evidence by not looking at it. It was made available to them. They felt if they looked at it, they would have to deal with it and publish it. So they didn't deal with it. In 1977, around that time frame, the House Assassinations Committee had the photographs. What they did with it was even less excusable. They had the photographs, they had the questions that were brought to them about the photographs, and they did not allow the Dallas doctors, the most important witnesses in this particular area of the evidence, to even view them. And the reason seems quite clear. If they have the best eyewitnesses looking at the photographs saying that's not the condition of the president's head, then you not only have a conspiracy to kill the president, but absolute proof of the conspiracy to cover it up after the fact, because the only people who had the photographs were the government. If somebody faked those photographs, it was someone within the government, someone who had access to those photographs.
But there are further disturbing indications of manipulation of the medical evidence in the hours prior to the autopsy at Bethesda. Dallas doctor Robert McClelland.
I would estimate that about 20% to 25% of the entire brain was missing.
My job in working with autopsies was to remove the brain. What struck me was when we removed the sheet, I looked down, I said, my God, he didn't have any brains left, literally. I was just astounded by it. I think everybody else was too, but there was just a gasp throughout the room. There was no brain to be removed at all.
At any normal autopsy involving such gunshot wounds, the brain would have been sectioned and the bullet tracks traced and all bullet fragments examined. This was not done. In Dealey Plaza, in the chaos immediately after the shooting, there'd been confusion about where the shots had come from. Over 50 known eyewitnesses believe that there was a gunman up on the grassy knoll.
I'm convinced, and no one will ever convince me any differently, that the shots came from the area of the picket fence on the grassy knoll. No one will ever convince me. I saw it. I believe that's where it came from. And the only way that I'm ever going to believe any different is when I stand before the judge on the judgment day and he tells me. But I know what I saw, and that's what I saw.
Major Phil Willis, with his wife and daughter, was also in Dealey Plaza. He is certain that the fatal headshot came from the grassy knoll.
Hell, I'll tell you, 90% of the people in Dallas, Texas, and probably the United States have heard all this over, have since decided that, as well as the second investigation held in the House of Representatives in Washington. And no one will ever convince me. I know damn well the shot that blew his head off came from the right front.
It's a very valid criticism of the Warren Commission that it failed to follow up many, many important leads and witnesses that came to its attention. One of the best examples, I think, is the fake Secret Service man up on the grassy knoll and a Dallas police officer. Within a minute or two after the shooting, Officer Joe Marshall Smith ran up on the grassy knoll following the other witnesses. That's where they all went initially. And Joe Smith pulled his pistol when he spotted a man behind the picket fence up on the grassy knoll. And this is a man dressed in coat and tie. And this man, even looking right into Smith's revolver, said, hey, I'm Secret Service. And he pulled out some credentials that, to Officer Smith, indicated that this man was legitimate. Smith left him alone and went away, investigating other areas in the plaza. The important part is that the Secret Service at no time had any agents anywhere in Dealey Plaza, with the exception of the agents who were riding in the motorcade. So here's a guy passing himself off as a Secret Service agent to a Dallas police officer, and there was no Secret Service agent there. The Warren Commission either didn't know that or didn't want to know. They didn't even ask Officer Smith pertinent questions about that encounter. And to me, that's one of the great failings of the Warren Commission, and a typical example how important evidence was overlooked initially or lost at that time.
Tell us exactly what you saw, sir.
Yeah.
He was coming down the street, and my five-year-old boy and myself were by ourselves on the grass there on Palmer Street, and I asked Joe to wave to him, and Joe waved, and I waved, and
That's all right, sir. You waved.
It was frightening. They took me and my five-year-old boy because we were surrounded by the two busloads of people there. They had asked me, how do you know it was rifle shots? Were you ever in the Army? I said, yes, I was not only in the Army, I was in combat, and I pulled up my sleeve and showed them my arm and said that I've had bullet holes in me. So this started the crowd around me. Well, some of the police thought that I was possibly the guilty party, and they took me right to the front door of the school book depository where a police car was parked and put me and little Joe in the police car. Well, an awful lot of the people who were passing by there thought that I had did it, and I was pounding on the car and calling me names that you don't repeat in good company. And there were an awful lot of... You didn't know the cops from the robbers.
After the assassination, Beverly was contacted at work by FBI agents who took her undeveloped film and promised to return it within 10 days. She has not seen it since.
From the position that I was filming, I had the best shot of the assassination, and probably the only one that had a real good shot of the grassy knoll. And probably would be a lot of unanswered questions answered if my film could be found.
Fortunately, a few feet to Beverly's left, Mary Ann Moorman in the dark coat took her picture a split second after the president had been fatally struck in the head. Although frequently examined by the FBI, her historic snapshot was too widely publicized to disappear.
We know that the president's car was in the center.
Its dramatic secret, however, has only recently been uncovered. After 5 years of intensive study of the Mormon picture by two researchers in Texas, Jack White and Gary Mack, there is at last convincing evidence of a gunman up on the grassy knoll.
Here is the guy that we call Badge Man, and it appears to me that from our study of it, his waist is right at the top of the wooden fence.
Gary Mack was the first to isolate the image, now known as Badge Man.
What I was looking at, to a lot of people, might have just been like looking at an inkblot or something, and all of a sudden I started to see eyes and ears and forehead and hair, and little by little the pieces of this image started to make sense to me, and that's when I first called Jack, and with his photographic work doing the blow-ups, we could see more and more and more detail, and at one point we realized that this fellow was probably wearing a police uniform or some type of uniform that was close enough to what the Dallas police were wearing, was so that he could pass as a police officer. And really, that to me, that was the one scary moment, because that was such a brilliant plan. A police officer in that location, away from where people were watching, if anyone did see him, they wouldn't think anything about it, because there were police in that area, although nowhere near where we see this guy. So this guy was an imposter. And I got chills then, because that was the realization that this was a very cleverly, well-thought-out plan.
You have to keep in mind that the Mary Mormon picture is about this size, and the area that we're dealing with is about a quarter inch square. So the area that Badge Man appears in is very tiny, and that's why the attempts to enhance it photographically have been very difficult over the years.
This small area was the scene of an extraordinary encounter. Behind the picket fence, there is a car park, and in 1963, Gordon Arnold was a 22-year-old serviceman, just out of training camp and en route to a posting in Alaska. This is his first film interview.
On that particular morning, what happened was I came downtown and I thought there was going to be a parade. So what I did was I parked my vehicle back here in this parking lot, and I intentionally walked to this particular corner because I wanted to take pictures of the parade off of the railroad bridge. Well, this is about as far as I got, because what happened is when I got my leg to about this position, a man came around the corner off the bridge, had a suit on, and he turned around and he told me that I wasn't going to be there. And I guess I was younger and more spunky at that time, because I told him, you and who else is going to keep me off the bridge. And he pulled out an identification card and he said, I'm with the CIA. And I said, well, that's enough muscle, I'll leave. So I turned around and I brought my leg back over like this. I walked down the fence line here about halfway. And I was looking over the fence to see if I could get a good shot of the parade. And he come back up and he told me, he says, I told you to get out of this area. And I said, okay. So I walked the complete length of the fence, got around on the other side. That's when I started to line up my frame so that I could take the picture of the parade. I had been panning shots through here so that I could get whatever was going to come down the street. And I saw that it was the President of the United States. And as I was panning down this direction, just as I got to about this position, a shot came right past my left ear. And that meant it would have had to have come from this direction. And that's when I fell down. And to me, it seemed like a second shot was at least fired over my head. There's a bunch of report going on in this particular area at that time. And what happened was that while I was laying on the ground, it seemed like a gentleman came from this particular direction. And I thought it was a police officer because he had a uniform of a police officer. But he didn't wear a hat. And he had dirty hands. But it didn't really matter much at that time, because with him crying like he was, and with him shaking when he had the weapon in his hand, I think I'd have gave him almost anything except the camera, because that was my mother's. And literally what the man did was kick me and asked me if I was taking a picture. I told him that I was. And when I looked at the weapon, it was about that big around, and I decided I'd let him go ahead and have the film. I gave it to him, and then he went back off in this direction. I went off in this direction. And 3 days later, I was in Alaska. and I didn't come back to the United States for about 18 months.
We spent a lot of time studying the picture and looking at little details, and I guess in the back of our minds was a story that had come out 4 years earlier by a man named Gordon Arnold, who claimed to be a witness to the assassination and claimed to have been standing up by the fence. And there was a light blob of something very close to where Badge Man was, and we weren't sure what it was, but gradually as details started coming out with Jack's photo work, we realized that this image was probably Gordon Arnold. And here's a guy who had told his story just to an acquaintance and was overheard, and that story went off to the news media, and Gordon Arnold was interviewed, and it appeared in the newspaper that he had been at the scene and was in that location, but no one believed him because there were no photographs or films that showed a man in that position. But all of a sudden, the Mormon picture confirmed his story. And again, the interesting part is that Gordon Arnold's story came out 4 years before we noticed the appearance of this figure in the Mormon photograph.
We later learned that Arnold was wearing this army cap that had a slight point at the top and a medallion on the right-hand side that said U.S. Army, and it's exactly what we see in the photograph. We also know that Gordon Arnold was filming this scene with a movie camera, and that's exactly what the photograph shows, because we see the right arm of the person in this position with his hand up toward his face and what appears to be obstructing his face, something perhaps like a movie camera.
Check that measurement once again.
Yeah, this is about
Gary and Jack's work has been verified and duplicated by independent experts in Great Britain. Measurements taken in Dealey Plaza and from Mary Ann's original camera confirm that it was possible for the Badgeman figure to have fired the fatal headshot.
Excellent view of the street from here. See the center lane, which is where the president was, and see that whole lane for almost the entire period. It's a great position to be in.
But the photograph had yet more to reveal.
I was sitting in my office here one day looking at the picture, and I saw what appeared to be another image standing directly behind the badge man. This appears to be a person in a hard hat and a white t-shirt. The lighting on him is entirely consistent with the lighting on badge man. In other words, there's a highlight on the construction helmet that he seemed to be wearing. There's a shadow of his head down on his shoulders, and the lighting source is absolutely consistent with the rest of the picture. He appears to be looking off in the direction of the school book depository.
It was important in all this work that we developed somehow some independent corroboration for what we were seeing. And one of the important and yet often neglected witnesses in the Kennedy case is a railroad signalman named Lee Bowers, who was working in a railroad tower behind the picket fence and behind the grassy knoll. And he had a good view of the area where we see these figures. And he testified to the Warren Commission and told them that when Kennedy appeared in Dealey Plaza, there were two men behind the fence that he could see. And these two men were in this one position the whole time before, during, and after the shooting.
Lee Bowers died in a mysterious car accident 2.5 years after the assassination. Ed Hoffman, a deaf-mute who is interviewed here for the first time.
I'd gotten off work early because I had a dentist's appointment. I was traveling down the freeway here, and I remembered that President Kennedy was coming to visit Dallas. I parked my car here. I realized at this spot that I would be able to see Kennedy pass close by. I stood here and waited, and I was looking towards where he would be coming from. I suddenly saw two men who looked suspicious directly over there in the car park.
25 years ago, these trees did not obscure the view. From his position at the side of the freeway, Ed Hoffman could clearly see the car park area behind the grassy knoll.
I saw a man standing here, wearing a black hat and a blue jacket. I saw a puff of smoke, and I thought it was a cigarette, but it wasn't. He had a gun, and he walked towards the railroad. He tossed the gun to the second man. Then he turned and straightened his jacket, adjusted his hat, and walked casually away. The man with the striped shirt, the railroad shirt, walked over to the electrical box with the gun. He took the gun apart. He put it in a toolbox. He then walked slowly away in the direction of the railroad track. When the motorcade passed by below me here, I realized that Kennedy had been shot. I was horrified. I saw a policeman standing on the railroad bridge, and I tried to get his attention, but he didn't see me. So I got in my car and drove to the area where I had seen the two men. But there were so many people there, and I couldn't find them. I went to the FBI to tell them what I had seen. They didn't want me to say anything. They offered me money to keep quiet. They didn't understand that it was more important for me to tell them what I'd seen. It was hard for me to communicate with them. I do feel that the two men I saw were working together, and that the one with the gun behind the fence was the man who shot President Kennedy.
Look at the situation. The FBI started in the investigation right away, and they had all these reports, over 50 reports from eyewitnesses saying at least one of the shots came from that area. And here, all of a sudden, they've got a photograph that shows the precise area within a sixth of a second of when the president's head explodes. Someone, somewhere in the FBI must have wondered, perhaps the gunman is in this picture. And I think they knew the evening of the assassination that there was a second gunman up in the grassy knoll. The medical evidence as it exists now does not indicate a shot from the front. But we do have to understand that if Badge Man was firing, and if it was Badge Man's shot that struck the president in the head, that means the medical evidence has been altered. And there you've got conspiracy existing within the United States government.
Despite the government, Gordon Arnold is certain of what he saw.
The training that I had just finished, they were shooting live ammunition openers. And when a bullet goes past your ear and your eardrum feels like it's coming out the other side of your head, it's close. That's why I thought I was shot. There's no doubt in my mind that I was there, and it did occur.
Further verification of Gordon's presence on the knoll comes from a surprising source, Senator Yarborough.
During that shooting, my eye was attracted to the right and saw a movement, and I saw a man just jump about 10 feet like at the old-time flying tackle in football and land against a wall. I thought to myself, there's an infantryman who's either been shot at in combat or he's been trained thoroughly. The minute you hear firing, get under cover.
This colorized version of the Badgeman picture was shown to Gordon Arnold for the first time. He has always believed there was no proof of his presence on the knoll that day.
Looks like a soldier in summer uniform with an overseas cap on. It looks like it would have been my uniform. It looks like there's a camera, or there's something up in front of the face. It looks like a white spot. If it's a flash, it would be like off of a muzzle flash. This looks like a police officer, because that would be the badge. That would be the arm emblem. Would this fella back here be the railroad man I asked you about this morning? Because when I was walking to the site, and I had never told anybody that I had, when we were out there filming, it reminded me that there was a railroad worker just standing out there by the railroad tracks. But that, it looks like somebody's taking a picture. Yeah, I couldn't figure out why would I be standing crooked until I flipped that up, and if that's a muzzle blast or flash, then whoever's standing there would have been a fool to stand up straight. He'd been trying to get away from harm's way is what it boils down to. And that could very well be me.
son of a gun. That would be the closest thing that I've ever. To be honest with you, the picture bothers me because if this is a true thing, if what has occurred, then I could be the only one that. Saw the man. They killed the president. And to be honest with you, if I'd have known this, I wouldn't have given the interview. Because that hits too close to home right now.
If the figure is real, then that means the witnesses were correct, and the researchers who have spoken of conspiracy for 25 years now were also correct. It means the Warren Commission was wrong. There was a conspiracy. The question then is, who was involved in the conspiracy? And alongside with that is, was Lee Harvey Oswald involved in the conspiracy? One of the good things the Warren Commission did was literally itemize the last few days of Lee Harvey Oswald's life. And the problem for the Warren Commission now would become, well, he had no opportunity to be with other people to plan something like this. So we now have to wonder seriously, perhaps for the first time, whether Lee Harvey Oswald even fired any shots.
In the ensuing chaos, police officers at first acted independently. But within minutes, their attention was focused on the Texas School Book Depository building and its open windows. All the floors were systematically searched, but the first hard evidence was discovered in the southeast corner of the sixth floor by Dallas Police Detective Luke Mooney.
I immediately saw the area with some books had been stacked up and the window was half open. Now this window was not all the way open, it was only a half pane open, which is something of this nature, high up off the windowsill. And I spotted the spent cottages. They were lying approximately in this position. The first one was here. The second one was a foot or so from the other one. And then the third one was over in this approximate position, which the open window was like this, more so to speak, but it's an angle. I secured the area and let no one into that particular spot where the sniper's nest was, where I had seen the spent shells. And someone brought the message up that the president was DOA, was deceased. And at that time, you could have heard a pin drop. You talk about touching your heart, it did. And, pardon me. We were standing there talking and trying to reach our composure. And this wasn't brought out in the statement that there was a book there, and she looked over at it, and the was open, and why on this face of this book was about this size was a picture of Christ. And it says, Christ leads the way.
Later, a rifle was found on the same floor by Deputy Sheriff Eugene Boone.
In the far corner of the stairwell, you could not see this corner of the building at all from the stairwell. That's where I found the rifle over in the northwest corner of the building. There were two rows of books. The outside row was two cases high, and as I looked in the crevice, I saw the rifle in there.
It was an Italian Manica Cucano of World War II vintage, worn and rusty and with a misaligned scope. Despite intense efforts over a three-day period, the Dallas police and the FBI were only able to find Oswald's smudged palm print on the rifle after his death. Forty-five minutes after the assassination, a police patrolman, J.D. Tippett, was shot dead in the Oak Cliff area of Dallas, 3 miles from downtown. Squad cars swiftly converged on the Texas Theater, a mile from the scene of the shooting. A man behaving suspiciously had slipped inside without paying and disappeared into the upper balcony. One of the first police officers on the scene was Paul Bentley.
I came down from the balcony and entered the theater from this door right here. Oswald was sitting in this chair, and just as I entered, he jumped up as McDonald came up in front of him, Officer McDonald. He immediately pulled a gun from his waist. As I saw him pull the pistol, I dove over the seats and struggled, came down on the side of Oswald, or the suspect, struggling with him. I scraped his forehead with the bottom of this ring. I had some of the skin from his forehead under the ring when I got to the city hall.
The way he acted, you'd think he'd merely been arrested for perhaps a traffic ticket, because he never had the usual symptoms of nervousness, like breaking out in a sweat or shaking or anything like that. He was just a real cool individual. And you'd never think, just by looking at him, that he was the one that was going to be accused of killing the president and Officer Tippett.
Oswald, the enigmatic ex-Marine who briefly defected to Russia and was working at the book depository on the day of the assassination, claimed he was in the second floor lunchroom at the time of the shooting. The first to interrogate him was Gus Rose.
I looked up and I saw some officers bringing a man in who was handcuffed. And when I asked them what they had, one of the officers told me that they had the man here who had killed Officer Tippett. And I took the handcuffs off of Oswald and asked him who he was. He refused to tell me, so I searched him. And in his pocket, he had a wallet, and in the wallet was two pieces of identification. One card said Lee Oswald, the other said Alex Heidel. When I asked him who that was or which one of these he was, well, he became belligerent and something to the effect, he said, "You're the cop, you figure it out."
Oswald, did you shoot the president?
I didn't shoot anybody, sir. I haven't been told what I'm here for.
Do you have a lawyer?
No, sir, I don't.
The gun was fired one time by the suspect, but luckily it misfired.
Fought with us like a wild man.
Is there any doubt in your mind, Chief, that Oswald is the man who killed the president?
I think this is the man that killed the president.
From the moment of his arrest, Oswald was presumed guilty and portrayed to the world as a lone nut assassin. But he vehemently protested his innocence at every opportunity.
Well, what this situation is about, nobody has told me anything except that I'm accused of murdering a policeman. I know nothing more than that, and I do request someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about it was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
You have been.
Nobody said what?
Sir?
You have been.
Nobody said what?
Okay, man, here you go.
Okay.
Visibly shaken by this news, Oswald was to be interrogated for a further 36 hours.
A policeman hit me.
Before his transfer to the county jail.
You regard the county jail as a more secure place to house the prisoner. Is that why you're transferring him from the city jail?
It's customary after a man is filed on that he be transferred. We only keep him in our jail until he is filed on. Necessary precautions will be taken, of course, but I don't think that the people will try to take the prisoner away from us.
On the Sunday morning, Oswald was escorted through the basement of police headquarters by Detectives Jim Lavelle and L.C. Graves.
Jim Lavelle and myself and Oswald stepped off the elevator, walked a few steps and waited till we got the all clear signal to go on out to the where the car was supposed to be parked waiting for us.
But the car was not in place. Consequently, when I walked out, I was looking to my right where the car was being backed into position. But it wasn't quite, wasn't where it ought to be. I could see this crowd of people to my left, which include police officers and news reporters, cameramen and so forth. I saw Ruby in this crowd to my left. He was standing on the front with a pistol in his hand down at his side.
I caught him out of the corner of my eye, and then I started, of course, getting loose from Oswald where I could grab the gun. But before I could grab the gun, he had already gotten one shot off, so I grabbed his wrist and the gun simultaneously and just spun around with him.
There's the pistol. There is Leon.
He's been shot.
A shot rang up.
Mass confusion.
There's the man with
a gun. And I not got that gun. He may, in the excitement, shot off some more rounds because he was still squeezing on that trigger in an attempt to shoot that pistol again.
I think Oswald really died just a short distance from the hospital because he stretched out every muscle in him tight, and he just said, and then went totally limp. And as far as I know, he didn't make any move or sound after that.
Mr. Oswald died at 1:07 our time in the operating room of the gunshot wound which he had received.
Lee Harvey Oswald is a question mark to history. The debate is often raised, was Lee Harvey Oswald alone as the assassin, or was he part of a conspiracy? The question is never raised, is it possible that he didn't do it at all?
6 weeks before the assassination, Oswald had taken a low-paid job as an order filler at the school book depository in downtown Dallas. Because of his impoverished circumstances, Oswald was living in the modest residential district of Oak Cliff, 4 miles out of town. Although married with two young daughters, weeknights were spent alone at this seedy rooming house at 1026 North Beckley, where Oswald had mysteriously registered under the name of O.H. Lee. Most weekends, however, he visited his Russian-born wife, Marina, and their baby daughters, who lived on the far side of town in the Irving district of Dallas. Unable to drive, he would hitch a lift with a fellow worker to this house, where his family lodged with the woman who had befriended them, a Quaker called Ruth Payne.
The idea of his having shot the president skews what everyone thinks, it seems to me, and we forget how ordinary he was, or how he would play with his children and with mine at the house on weekends. And my main memory of him is of his watching the football games on Saturday and Sunday, and he enjoyed watching the games on the TV set. He seemed concerned about his little girls, very much so.
Oswald loved being the family man. The colleague who drove him out to see them at weekends and lived only a few doors away witnessed that affection firsthand. Ewell Wesley Frazier.
He liked children very much. That's one of the things that I could get Lee to talk about. When Lee came home with me on Friday afternoon and rode back on with me on Monday morning, I never saw him or did anything with him at that time, but evidently the children in the neighborhood, all of them at one time or other, seemed to find their way up to the Payne house where Lee lived to play with him and his daughter. On November the 21st, I was working at Texas School Books Depository. Oswald came up to me and he asked if he could ride home with me, and I said, sure. And then a little bit later, I realized it wasn't Friday. And the next time I saw him, I said, well, today's not Friday, Lee. And he says, I know that. He says, it's Thursday. He says, Marina has made some curtains for me, and they have some curtain rods out there. And he says, I'm going to get the curtain rods to put the curtains up in my apartment. And I said, okay.
He had never come out without asking permission before, besides the fact that it was a weeknight. And he arrived, actually, I was out of the house when he arrived. I was grocery shopping. We bought a lot of groceries. And then he was there already playing with his children on the front lawn when I arrived about 5:30. As we went by each other, I said, very, very, very happy in Russian, our president is coming. And he just sort of brushed on by without saying anything or no really reaction. And in a way, that was typical of him, so I gave it very little thought. He often didn't respond very much. But I think that evening he was especially quiet at dinner, and he went to bed very early.
On the morning of the assassination, Oswald overslept. Leaving money and his wedding ring behind, he hurried down the street to secure his ride to work with Frazier. Under his arm, he carried a brown paper package. Did this contain the gun that killed the President of the United States?
The first time I saw the package, it was on the back seat of my car, and I just glanced at it. And I asked, I said, what's that, Lee? And he said, that's curtain rods. He said, remember I was going to bring them? The length of the package that I saw that morning was roughly 2 foot long, give or take an inch or two. And it was made out of the same type of packing material that you would find in any a company that packed materials for shipment. It's just the brown paper and the tape that you'd normally find. Nothing unusual. What we actually talked about that morning was that I said, President Kennedy is going to be coming to town today. And I said, you know, I've never seen a president. I said, I sure would like to get a chance to see him up close.
Well, at that time, I didn't know that the motorcade in which he would be riding would come right by where we worked. He did not make any comment at all about where the president was coming to town. It didn't seem to interest him one way or the other. I parked in the parking lot at Texas School Book Depository. Lee got out of the car, took the package that he said contained curtain rods, and he put one end of the package in the cup of his hand and the other up under his armpit. He put the package under his arm that way, and he walked off toward Texas School Book Depository up on Elm Street.
The package could not have contained Oswald's rifle, for even when dismantled, it was 3 feet long. The Warren commissioners, who investigated the assassination, ignored Frazier's unswerving testimony, insisting the weapon had been smuggled into the depository in Oswald's brown paper parcel.
As far as eyewitnesses go, there was a woman named Carolyn Arnold who spoke to Oswald on the second floor moments before the shooting. Now, the motorcade was running 6 minutes late. Oswald, had he been up there, would have had no way of knowing this. He would have been up there on the sixth floor. He would have been waiting for at least 10 or 15 minutes in that so-called sniper's perch to shoot at President Kennedy as he either came toward the depository or as he went toward the triple underpass. One way or the other, he would have had to be up there at that time. He wouldn't be in the lunchroom on the second floor.
What I remember is being told that it was an oral report rather than a visual one, that the president had been shot. And then it was really quite a while later that we heard that he had died. And when I first heard that he'd been shot, I went and got a little votive candle and lit that. And Marina said, "Is that a way of praying?" And I said, "Yes, that's just sort of my way." We were both just very distressed and, you know, let lunch sit on the table. Neither interested in eating as we followed the coverage. A little later on, you know, life went on. We had children to take care of, and she was hanging out some laundry in the back line when I heard on the TV that the shots were thought to have been fired from the school book depository building.
Now riding the back trails of Texas, a former Dallas motorcycle officer recalls a remarkable encounter he had within 90 seconds of the assassination. The first policeman into the depository was Marion Baker.
I worked for the Dallas Police Department as a motorcycle officer and signed the motorcade that day. I was approximately five or six cars back from the lead car of the motorcade. I had gotten about halfway between Maine and Houston when I heard these three shots. And immediately, I knew they was in front of me and high. And as I looked up, I saw this huge flock of pigeons flying from the top of this building. I rode my motorcycle over to the corner of the intersection, parked it, and then ran in the building, which took me a very few seconds to do this. When I got through the front doors into the lobby of the building, I asked where the elevators or the stairs would be. And one man spoke up, said, "I'm Mr. Truly, I'm the building manager." And he said, "Come on, officer, I'll show you." So he and I continued on to the back of the building and up some stairways at the back of the building to the second floor. As we came out of the second floor, I saw through a doorway, a window in this doorway, a movement. So I went over and opened up the door, and this man was walking away from it in the next room. I later found out was a coffee room.
As seen earlier by his fellow workers, Oswald was still alone in the lunchroom.
I called to the man, and he turned around, and Mr. Truly was there beside me, and I asked him if he knew this man or if he worked there. He said, "Yes, he does." He was calm, ordinary, you know. He didn't look excited or anything like that.
In order to fire the shots from the sixth floor, Oswald needed to squeeze his way out of the sniper's perch, pick his way between stacks of books to the far side of the building, hiding the gun en route, descend four flights of stairs to the lunchroom unobserved, and yet appear calm and unruffled in his encounter with Officer Baker, all within 90 seconds. Less than 15 minutes after the shooting, the police were broadcasting a wanted description that closely fitted Oswald. Who provided that description is not known, but it led to the immediate arrest of Oswald lookalikes, even in Fort Worth, 30 miles away.
Attention all squad. The suspect in the shooting at Elm in Houston is reported to be an unknown white male, approximately 30, slender build, height 5 feet 10 inches, weight 165 pounds, reported to be armed with what is thought to be a 30 caliber rifle.
Meanwhile, the real Oswald had made his way to a taxi rank a short distance from the depository, and after politely offering the first cab in line to another passenger, had asked to be driven to the street where he lived in Oak Cliff. At his lodgings, he rushed to his room, collected a jacket and revolver, and was last seen by his landlady shortly after 1 p.m., standing at the bus stop outside 1026 North Beckley. A mile from Oswald's rooming house, in another part of Oak Cliff, a further drama was unfolding. Waitress Helen Markham, on her way to work, was about to become the principal witness to a brutal slaying.
I was standing here on this corner, waiting on the traffic to pass so I could go down there and catch my bus to go to work. And a man come walking down the sidewalk, and a policeman came. And I could not get across.
The policeman in a patrol car was Officer J.D. Tippett. According to Helen Markham's account, Tippett stopped his car and got out to continue his conversation with the man on the sidewalk.
Just as the policeman got in front of the hood of the car, that man shot him three or four times. And then he put his gun back in his pants. He run over here, and I put my hands, I seen him coming, I just put my hands up on my face like this. I waited for a few minutes, and I opened them up, and I pulled them down. And he looked at me, and I looked at him, and I never said a word. And just like a flash of lightning, with big glassy eyes, he run off across the field, out that lot there, down, right across there, went over the fence and down the alley.
With Helen Markham, car dealer Ted Calloway was to become a principal witness for the Warren Commission. At a police identity parade later that day, they both picked out Lee Harvey Oswald as the killer of Officer J.D. Tippett.
I was sitting in my office when I heard what sounded to be five pistol shots coming from behind my office in the direction of 10th Street. Well, I jumped up, ran out to the sidewalk, and as I did, I saw a man jump through the hedge carrying a pistol. And he angled across the street to the sidewalk and continued to run in my direction, holding his pistol. When he got almost directly across from me, I yelled at him, "Hey man, what the hell is going on?" And he had his pistol right here, and he nearly stopped, and he turned in my direction and said something, but I couldn't understand what he said. So he continued walking down Patton Street. I called to a friend of mine. I said, "Follow that guy, see where he's going."
The different routes taken by the fleeing assailant were not the only contradictions in the accounts of these key witnesses.
He was wearing a light shirt, a brown jacket, and a light gray trousers.
He was wearing a black pair of trousers, a white shirt, and either a real light tan or a light gray Eisenhower type windbreaker.
He was a short man, tiny small, and with a ruddy complexion.
He had real fair complexion, dark hair, and I found out later, the reason he had such fair complexion, that he'd killed a police officer and he was scared to death. So what it was, he was as pale as a ghost.
This man has devoted more time and energy than anyone to investigating the murder of Officer Tippett in Oak Cliff. After 12 years, researcher Larry Harris has uncovered important new evidence.
The Warren report concluded that Oswald had been walking east on 10th Street at the time he was encountered by Officer Tippett. And yet virtually all of the police, FBI, and Secret Service written reports from that weekend stated clearly that the man had been walking west on 10th Street, the opposite direction of Oswald. One of the witnesses, the so state, was Jim Burt, who was located on the corner of Denver and 10th Street. He sat on his front porch and stated he watched the man walking west on 10th Street up to the point where he encountered the police officer, and this is the man who did the shooting. The fact of the matter is that after 25 years, it's unclear just what transpired during the shooting here at 10th and Patton. One of the witnesses not known to the Warren Commission was a woman named Aquila Clemens, who was located in a house on the opposite side of the street. She came out immediately after the shooting and said she saw two men, one of whom was short and chunky, standing near the police car, and these men ran off in opposite directions. The bullets recovered from Tippett's body could not be traced to Oswald's revolver, nor apparently to any other revolver. There were references on the police radio tapes to an automatic weapon, two references. This is highly significant because Oswald was carrying a six-shot revolver, not an automatic. According to the Warren report, Oswald continued on in a westerly direction toward the Texas Theater and was able to reverse the six-block distance unimpeded, even though Jefferson Boulevard was swarming with police cars and bystanders searching for the suspect and closely scrutinizing any single white male that would have been walking in the area.
I don't know what this is all about.
Back up, man.
Here in Dallas, the man all America is looking at this time is 24-year-old Lee H. Oswald, being interrogated at the Dallas City Police Building. At the time of his arrest in a theater in the Oak Cliff section of Dallas, he was subdued after killing a Dallas police officer with a snub-nosed revolver, struggling with another officer, striking him with that pistol. And during that struggle, he was heard to shout, "It's all over now. I got me a president and a cop, and I'll try for two more."
Oswald was placed in four different lineups, three on Friday, a fourth on Saturday. In the first two lineups, Oswald appeared with two police detectives and a jail clerk. These men were wearing clothing quite a bit nicer than Oswald, but moreover, they did not resemble Oswald in appearance. They were heavier, older. One of them had blonde hair. The police gave fictitious names and occupations. Oswald gave his real name, his real occupation, to Texas School Book Depository. This information was being widely disseminated even by the time of the first lineup. In the second and third lineups, Oswald appeared with men who were quite a bit heavier, older. Some of them had blonde hair. And in the fourth lineup, which was the most outrageous of all, Oswald appeared in the lineup with two teenagers and a Mexican. And in the second, third, and fourth lineups, Oswald complained bitterly to police about the manner in which the lineups were being conducted. And he berated the police, demanded legal representation, and it was very, very apparent to any witnesses that Oswald was the suspect. There are established criteria for the fair and proper conduct of police lineups. By any stretch of the imagination, every rule in the book was violated by the Dallas police in the conduct of each of the four lineups that weekend.
When they first filed against Oswald for killing President Kennedy, they put in the complaint that Oswald did kill President Kennedy in the furtherance of an international communist conspiracy. The White House called down to the district attorney and vehemently objected to that, in which then the district attorney removed this statement from the original complaint. Because of this, the White House was extremely upset with the local authorities, and we were under the strictest orders not to give them any information whatsoever at all about Oswald. This caused them to jump to the wrong conclusion and think that we were hiding something about ourselves when we were really cloaking the information about Oswald's Soviet and Cuban connections.
The prime piece of evidence against Oswald seemed to be the antiquated bolt-action rifle discovered on the sixth floor of the depository 30 minutes after the assassination. However, both the FBI and the Dallas police were unable to positively tie the weapon to Oswald. This became a matter of increasing embarrassment to Police Chief Jesse Curry.
Chief, we understand you have the results of the paraffin tests which were made to determine whether Oswald had fired a weapon. Can you tell us what those tests
showed? I understand that it was positive.
What does that mean?
It only means that he fired a gun.
Were there powder burns or powder marks on his cheek?
I don't know that.
All you know about is on his hand.
Yes.
That he fired a gun, Chief, not the rifle or the pistol.
That's right.
As the police tried to build a case against Oswald, officers were dispatched to question his wife, Marina. They were led by Detective Gus Rose.
We drove to the 6th Street address in Irving, the address of Ruth Payne, and walked up the walk, and as I approached the door, a voice said, "Come on in, I've been expecting you." Questions that I asked Marina, I said, "Does your husband own a rifle?" She said, "Yes." And I said, "Do you know where it is?" And she said, "Yes." I said, "Can you show it to me?" And she said, "Yes." And she motioned for me to follow her. And she directed me into the kitchen part of the house where she opened a door that goes into a garage. And she pointed out in the garage to a rolled up blanket that was laying out there. And she said, being interpreted by Ruth Payne, "That's his rifle."
And the officer picked up the blanket roll and, you know, just hung over his arm. And that was the point at which I felt that he could have been the one that killed the president. And I had this flood of feeling of, you know, what they need to know. I'm going to help them know whatever they need to know. We're going to get to the bottom of this. But that was the first I had any inkling that he'd even had a gun.
Fire that rifle. What specific facts that you people have been given, but I emphatically deny these charges.
These basic fundamental hygienic rights, I mean, like a shower and a boat.
These people have given me a hearing without legal representation or anything.
Did you shoot the president?
I didn't shoot anybody, no, sir. I'm just a cadavy.
There is no official record of Oswald's many hours of interrogation.
Well, I was in the process of transferring him. Had a short conversation with him, and where I said, "Lee, if anybody shoots at you, I hope that they are as good a shot as you are." Meaning that I hope they, if they shot him, they'd hit him and not me. He kind of laughed and said, "Well, you're being melodramatic about it. I don't think anybody's going to shoot at me." And I said, "Well, in the event that they do shoot at you, you know what to do. You will be on the floor immediately." However, I didn't realize that just 2 or 3 minutes later, somebody would actually be shooting at him.
Even in Oswald's dying moments, the authorities desperately tried to wrest a confession from him. A surgeon, Paul Peters of Parkland Hospital, explains.
There were Secret Service men intermingled with the operating room personnel, as there were dozens of people in the operating suite at that time. And some were dressed in green clothes as the surgeons, so as to be indistinguishable from operating room personnel. And since it was known by those in the operating room that he was under little or no anesthesia, two or three people shouted in his ear, "Did you do it? Did you do it?" Which led me as a layman to speculate that perhaps a full-fledged confession might not yet have been obtained from Mr. Oswald.
Determined efforts by the Dallas police and the FBI in Washington had still failed to tie the prized rifle to Oswald. However, a smudged palm print was discovered on the weapon hours after a mysterious visit to the funeral home where Oswald's body had been taken by mortician Paul Grudy.
I had gotten to the funeral home with his body something in the neighborhood of 11 o'clock at night, and it is a several hour procedure to prepare the remains. And after this time, someplace in the early morning, agents came. Now, I say agents because I'm not familiar at the moment with whether they were Secret Service or FBI or what they were. But agents did come, and when they did come, they fingerprinted. And the only reason that we knew they did, they were carrying a satchel and the equipment, and asked us if they might have the preparation room to themselves. And after it was all over, we found ink on Lee Harvey's hands, showing that they had fingerprinted him and palm printed him. We had to take that ink back off in order to prepare him for burial and to eliminate that ink.
Well, Oswald is a pretty interesting fellow. He's not nearly the one-dimensional character that the Warren Commission has painted him to be. He was in the Marine Corps and did very well. He had a high security clearance. He was stationed over at Sugi. He was a radar operator. In fact, he was one of the guys that would track the U-2 flights over Russia. So it's not like he was the perennial loser that we tend to have this image of him now.
One person with no illusions about Oswald's role launched his own investigation into the Kennedy assassination in 1967. the former district attorney of New Orleans, Judge Jim Garrison.
He was employed by the Central Intelligence Agency, and he was obviously drawn into a scapegoat situation and made to believe, ultimately, that he was penetrating the assassination. And then when the time came, they took the scapegoat, the man who thought he was working for the United States government, and killed him real quick. And then the machinery, disinformation machinery started turning, and they started making a villain out of a man who genuinely was probably a hero.
6 months before the assassination, Oswald had taken a mundane job with the Riley Coffee Company. But it seems his real activities were centered a few blocks away. From a small office on the corner of Lafayette and Camp Street, Oswald managed a local chapter of the pro-Castro Fair Play for Cuba Committee. Operating from an adjoining office was a sinister figure named Guy Bannister.
About Guy Bannister, it's difficult to say much about him because he always stood in the shadows and pushed someone else to the front. He was a strongly disciplined man, perhaps the outgrowth of his many years as a special agent in charge of the Chicago office of the FBI. But he was a key man in the assassination. And that's clear from the fact that Oswald's sheep-dipping, his being portrayed as a communist, was done out of Guy Bannister's office. So he was sheep-dipped for months as a communist by giving literature. Lee, hand this out today. This is your assignment. I came across the fact that Oswald, a private in the Marines, had taken a Russian examination. And I knew the privates did not take Russian examinations unless they were connected with intelligence. So that caused me to be curious about 544 Camp, which was the address stamped on one circular that they gave out one time before, obviously, Bannister told them, Lee, no more addresses. Turned out that was a side address of Guy Bannister's private detective agency. Well, I went down there to look at it, and I found myself not merely outside of Guy Bannister's office, but across the street from Naval Intelligence, across the street from Secret Service. Around the corner was the Crescent City garage, the garage for the intelligence community. And then two doors away, the Riley Coffee Company. I used to be in the FBI. I knew people in Naval Intelligence, and they were either across the street, around the corner. The whole intelligence community was there, and right in the middle of it was Guy Bannister having Oswald sheep-dipped as a communist.
Lee Harvey Oswald was not the individual who assassinated President Kennedy, nor was he the individual responsible for Policeman Tippett's death. I want to know why, after 25 years, the federal government of this country maintains that Oswald and Oswald alone was responsible for these murders.
The individual that I know is Lee Harvey Oswald. I don't think had in him to be a person capable of committing such a crime as murdering the President of the United States. I'll always believe that. The side I saw to him was a very kind and loving man. And that's the way I like to remember him.
Lee Oswald was totally, unequivocally, completely innocent of the assassination. And the fact that history, or in the rewriting of history, and disinformation has made a villain out of this young man who wanted nothing more than to be a fine Marine, is in some ways the greatest injustice of all.
Straight out of the realms of cheap fiction, Chicago's tough West Side and the birthplace of a notorious son. Jack Ruby, small-time hoodlum and runner for Al Capone in the 30s, based his life around gambling, narcotics, and prostitution. His Carousel Club in Dallas was one in a long line of unsuccessful nightclubs where Ruby often played host to members of the Dallas police force and the criminal underworld. A fitness freak, Ruby swam in this pool at his apartment every morning, but internally, his life was in chaos. In the months preceding the assassination, his phone calls from the Carousel Club and this apartment to well-connected mob figures increased 10 and 20-fold, a pattern which had begun with the announcement in late April of President Kennedy's intended visit to Dallas. A distinguished journalist who knew Ruby well was Seth Cantor.
In the weeks immediately before the assassination of the president, unaccountably, Ruby had visits from some members of the underworld who he had not even seen in a period of something like 20 years. In May of 1963, Ruby traveled to New Orleans to negotiate for one or more strippers for his club and dealt with a man named Harold Tenenbaum there. But New Orleans was and has continued to be controlled by a very powerful mafia figure named Carlos Marcello.
Marcello, a leading target of the Kennedy brothers' war on crime, had sworn vengeance against them. His interests in Bourbon Street were first visited by Ruby in June 1963, ostensibly to recruit fresh flesh for his Carousel Club. This dancer at the show bar, known as Jada, was signed up by Ruby. But was she the cover for more serious underworld business?
Ruby's connections with nightclub people in New Orleans meant that one way or another he was dealing with Marcello associates. He had telephone contacts and personal contacts with various well-known gunmen and thugs who regularly serviced the underworld in Chicago, Miami, Las Vegas, Houston, and in New Orleans.
These underworld links were never investigated by the Warren Commission, who found no evidence of a conspiracy. They also found no connection between Ruby and Oswald. Interviewed for the first time, former nightclub singer Beverly Oliver has finally broken her silence of 25 years.
I purposely have waited this long. I've always felt very threatened. You know, a lot of folks that gave testimony are no longer around to give testimony any longer. I didn't want to become a statistic. I didn't want to be one of those people that shot myself in the back of the head with a shotgun. One night in particular, I recall about 2 weeks prior to the assassination, being in the club, parking lot separated his club, the Carousel, and the club that I worked at, the Colony Club. So in between shows, the showgirls from the Colony Club would go over to Jack's club and watch their show, and in their show breaks, they would come and watch our show. So I had trotted over there that night and was watching the show. And there was a girl that danced there by the name of Jada. And she was sitting at the table with Jack Ruby and another man. And I went and sat down with them to have a drink. As I sat down at the table, Ruby introduced me to the man sitting there at the table with he and Jada. And he said, "Beverly, this is my friend, Lee." And after Jack Ruby went into the police station and killed Lee Harvey Oswald, it was then that I realized this was the man that I had met in the club 2 weeks prior to the assassination of Kennedy. Lee Harvey Oswald and Jack Ruby were linked together, and I don't know how, and probably I never will. But I know in my heart that man, Lee Harvey Oswald, or the person that was shot in the basement of the police station, was the man that was in the club 2 weeks prior to the assassination. As a matter of fact, the next day, Jada gave an interview to the newspaper, and she said the same thing that I'm saying to you now, that she met Oswald 2 weeks prior to the assassination of Kennedy. However unfortunate it is, Jada is dead, or so they tell me.
At Parkland Hospital, minutes after the tragedy, one member of the press corps who knew Jack Ruby well was to have an extraordinary encounter. Reporter Seth Cantor.
Just after I entered, there was a group of nurses and doctors standing around with a lot of concern, and Jack Ruby came up to me. He said something to the effect that, "Isn't this just terrible?" And he looked as if he was extremely distressed. I shook hands with him, and I had known him previously. And Ruby asked me what I thought about his closing his places of business for a day or two out of concern for what had happened. And I told him I thought that was a good idea, and to please excuse me, I had to go on. I guess that encounter with Ruby took maybe 25, 30 seconds. It was very clear to me who I had talked to and who I had called by name and who had called me by name and who I had shaken hands with and everything. But when the Warren Commission report came out, they said that probably under the stress of everything that was going on, that I most likely was confused and that I talked to Ruby at the police station several hours later.
Ruby denied he'd been at Parkland, and the Warren Commission believed him rather than Seth Cantor.
I was dismayed when I picked up my copy of the Warren Commission report and discovered what they had decided about my testimony. And among other things, I immediately began to wonder, you know, who else they had talked to, who they chose not to believe, and why.
A pristine bullet, which the commission was to allege had wounded both Kennedy and Connolly, magically appeared on a stretcher at Parkland. Jack Ruby's coincidental appearance inside the hospital was not the only fact the commissioners chose to ignore. Jack Ruby's close links with the Dallas police gave him easy access to their headquarters. On the assassination weekend, he was seen there several times, even correcting information about Oswald given out at a press conference. Was he stalking his prey?
They certainly didn't want to go into the fact that members of the American, of the United States underworld were dealing with the CIA in connection with the plans to get rid of Castro. Lyndon Johnson was very anxious for the Warren Commission to complete its work, to button things up and get out a report. And they were not anxious at all to open up areas of doubt or areas which needed further investigation. And one of those areas was the Jack Ruby business.
Ruby claimed he acted on impulse when he shot Oswald. His real motives were never explored. The Warren Commission believed everything Jack Ruby chose to tell them, including how he penetrated the basement security of Dallas police headquarters in order to kill Oswald.
I don't believe that Ruby entered the basement of the Dallas police station by way of the ramp from Main Street, which is the fiction that came about not long after he was arrested for killing Oswald. The policeman on duty at the top of the ramp was given a lie detector test, and he insisted that Ruby did not pass him at any time, and the lie detector test given by the police department bore that out.
Jack Ruby did not come down that ramp. I'll go to my grave saying he didn't come down that ramp. If anybody could have ever proved to me beyond a reasonable doubt that he came down that ramp, I feel that I was man enough to admit that, yes, maybe I made a mistake or was negligent in some area. But no, nobody's ever proved that to me, and I'll go to my grave saying that man did not come down that ramp.
Billy Grammer was a police communications officer on duty the night before Ruby killed Oswald. Around 9 p.m., he received an urgent message from a caller who refused to identify himself.
I thought I recognized the voice, but at the same time, I could not put a face or a name with the voice. And as we talked, he began telling me that we needed to change the plans on moving Oswald from the basement, that he knew of the plans to make the move, and if we did not make a change, the statement he made precisely was, we are going to kill him.
Billy Grammer reported the call, finished his shift, and went home to bed. He was asleep when Ruby, seen here on the edge of picture in his gray fedora, prepared to move in for the kill.
There is the prisoner. Do you have anything to say in your defense?
The first Billy Grammer knew of the slaying was the following morning when he switched on his television set.
No sooner than I turned it on and they were telling that Jack Ruby had killed Oswald, then I suddenly realized, you know, knowing Jack Ruby the way I did, this was the man I was talking to on the phone last night. At that time, I put the voice with the face, and I knew within myself that Jack Ruby is the one that made that call to me the night before. And I think it was obvious because he knew me and I knew him, and he called me by name over the telephone. And seeing this and knowing what I knew and what he had said, then to me it had to be Jack Ruby.
He is shot.
While his victim lay dying on the floor of the jail office, Ruby was dragged past him and taken up to Oswald's empty cell, where he was interrogated by Don Archer.
His behavior to begin with, he was very hyper. He was sweating profusely. I could see his heart. Of course, we had stripped him down for security purposes. He asked me for one of my cigarettes, so I gave him a cigarette. Finally, after about 2 hours had elapsed, which put it around 1 p.m., the head of the Secret Service came up, and I conferred with him, and he told me that Oswald had, in effect, died, and it should shock him, because it will mean the death penalty. So I returned and said, Jack, it looks like it's going to be the electric chair for you. Instead of being shocked, he became calm. He quit sweating. His heart slowed down. I asked him if he wanted a cigarette, and he advised me he didn't smoke. And I was just astonished that this was a complete difference in behavior of what I expected. I would say that his life had depended on him getting Oswald.
He made the statement, we are going to kill him. Which leads me to believe that this was not a spontaneous thing that happened on the spur of the moment. He was watching Oswald coming out the door, and all of a sudden he decided to shoot him. I do not believe that. I think this was a planned event with him being the man to do the shooting.
I told you earlier this morning, I think it's a waste of time. I have no chance whatsoever.
In March the following year, a sentence was passed on Jack Ruby.
We, the jury, find the defendant guilty of murder with malice as charged in the indictment and assess his punishment at death.
The world will never know the true facts of what occurred, my motives. The people that have so much to gain and have such an ulterior motive for putting me in a position I'm in will never let the true facts come above voice to the world.
Now, these people are in very high positions,
yeah? Yes.
Alan Dulles, director of the CIA, until Kennedy fired him, was one of the commissioners responsible for producing the 26-volume Warren Report on the president's assassination. The American media were glowing in their praise of the report that concluded Lee Harvey Oswald was alone responsible. It was only under closer scrutiny that the superficiality of its findings became clear.
The Warren Commission decided that there were three shots fired. First shot struck the president in the back, exited his throat, went on to strike Governor Connally in the back and exited in his right chest, and then went through his right wrist and then wound up embedded in his thigh, and the bullet fell out at Parkland Hospital. The Warren Commission also decided the second shot probably missed and flew off into Dealey Plaza somewhere. And the commission decided that the third shot struck the president in the head and killed him. And that's the official version of what happened. And it's interesting, one of the early researchers pointed out that no witness at any time has ever described the assassination as having happened that way. Only the Warren Commission came up with that interpretation, and it's the single assassin theory.
On the morning of the assassination, Bill and Gail Newman had gone down to Dealey Plaza with their children to watch the presidential motorcade pass. They were the closest spectators to the tragedy, and their account is echoed by many others who were there.
The first two shots, I didn't realize what they were, but the third shot, after it was fired, I heard Mrs. Kennedy scream, oh no, they've shot Jack, and it was just sort of sent a chill over you. It was just terrible.
I can remember seeing the side of the president's ear and head come off. I remember a flash of white and the red and just bits and pieces of flesh exploding from the president's head. At that time, I turned to Gail and said, that's it, hit the ground. And we turned and hit the ground and covered our children. But when the third shot was fired, I thought it came from directly behind towards the grassy knoll behind me. I based that primarily on the third shot. From what I saw of the side of the president's head coming off and from the sound of the rifle, the report of the rifle.
As the official story started coming out and hearing that the shots came from the building, these witnesses started to doubt their own ears. So as the days went by, fewer and fewer of these witnesses would come forward because they just all of a sudden weren't really sure about what they had heard. They were convinced on November 22, 63, that at least one shot came from the front. But by 4 or 5 days later, then they weren't sure, and they didn't come forward at all.
Mary Woodward was a junior reporter on the Dallas Morning News who had joined the lunchtime crowds in Dealey Plaza to watch the Kennedy motorcade. She was the journalist closest to the tragedy. and rushed back to her office to file the story in a state of great consternation.
They first of all took me to the office nurse and had me have a tranquilizer because they thought was somewhat hysterical. I think I was behaving quite rationally under the circumstances. But anyhow, I then sat down and wrote the story immediately and actually had completed the story before the news was absolutely confirmed that he was even dead. So the story was absolutely my own impressions. It was not from anything anyone had said or what I had read or heard. Some things I have often said I would hate to swear before a court of law or before God, but one thing I am totally positive of in my own mind is how many shots there were, and there were 3 shots. The second 2 shots were immediate. It was almost as if one were an echo of the other. They came so quickly. The sound of one did not cease until the second shot. With the second and third shots, I did see the president being hit. I literally saw his head explode. So I felt that the shots had come, as I wrote in my article, from behind me and to my right, which would have been in the direction of the grassy knoll and the railroad overpass.
Because it contradicted the sole assassin theory, Mary's eyewitness account was quickly pulled and her version discounted.
Civic leaders, responsible people, whether it be the mayor, the managing editor of the paper, almost felt it a responsibility to kind of not rock the boat, perhaps. The neat answer was the version that came to be the most widely accepted, that there were 3 shots and they had all come from the school book depository building and they were all fired by Lee Harvey Oswald.
We do know that the FBI, as the official investigative body for the Warren Commission, apparently collected all the possible evidence it could find that indicated Lee Harvey Oswald did it and did it alone. Other evidence that pointed to perhaps other people or other locations for shooters was either ignored or deemed to be mistaken or misinterpreted.
I was interviewed by the FBI, but I did not testify before the Warren Commission. It's my understanding the reason I did not go before the Warren Commission was because in my statement that I thought the shots came from directly behind implied the shots were coming from the grassy knoll. This is something apparently the Warren Commission did not want to hear. They wanted to keep the direction of the assassination in the direction of the school book depository.
On that tragic day in Dallas, the routine protection of the President of the United States was compromised from the very beginning, according to military expert Colonel Fletcher Prouty.
What they call protection of the president is an old skill. I went to Mexico City in 1956 when President Eisenhower went to Mexico City. And by that, I mean the security people went there more than a month early to look at every angle of the trip. There are rules and manuals on what we call protection. The Secret Service, that is an organization of limited size, is authorized to call any number of military people. And these are military people who are already trained to augment their forces in a case like this. There's no shortage of people. Ordinarily, a unit of military, I think was called a special group number 113, would have come up from San Antonio, Texas, and would have been deployed all through the streets of Dallas, the important streets of Dallas. That was not done. In fact, the commander was specifically told he wasn't needed. You've all seen the picture of the school book building, you know, where Oswald is supposed to have shot the president. You notice in those pictures there are open windows. If the Secret Service had been there and had done their usual job, none of those windows would have been open. And had anyone opened one of those windows at that time, they would have been on the radio, they would have had a man in that room immediately, and the window would have been closed. You see, that's protection. That didn't take place. In fact, there were no Secret Service people on the ground around Dealey Plaza that afternoon. They were told they were not needed.
There was further unprofessional conduct concealed at the time. The night before the assassination, most of the presidential bodyguard spent a drunken evening at this notorious Fort Worth nightclub, some staying until 5 a.m. Drinking alcohol while on a tour of duty contravened all Secret Service regulations. It could well explain their failure to react when the deadly shot strafed the presidential car only hours later in what was to be a classic ambush.
Instead of going straight down the street and then to the trademark, he made this 90-degree turn and then another very sharp turn in front of the school book depository building. Now, the Secret Service have rules against that. The rules are that if the car is slowed down below 44 miles an hour, you must then protect it fully in other ways, such as not digressing and going around corners and all that, because when you slowed him around that corner, you opened up field of fire from three directions, behind him, to the side, and from in front. And of course, he was killed right in that position that had been set up by the selection of that route.
Another long-standing critic of the official version of events has pursued the truth through the Freedom of Information Act, acquiring valuable documents which he believes prove a cover-up at the highest level. Former Senate investigator Harold Weisberg.
Lee Harvey Oswald was killed by Jack Ruby on Sunday, the 24th of November. Nicholas Katzenbach was the acting attorney general and the deputy attorney general, and he knew immediately that Oswald wasn't going to be tried. They didn't have to put this evidence into court. So he takes a lawyer's yellow Lego pad, he writes out in longhand a memorandum to Bill Moyers, that was the channel to Lyndon Johnson. And in essence, he says, we got to convince the world that Oswald was a lone assassin and that the evidence was such that he would have been convicted if he'd gone to trial. This is before they collected any evidence. This was Monday morning, Monday after the assassination.
The Dallas police were still collecting evidence and had to be stopped. After Oswald's death, the FBI swiftly requisitioned all the physical evidence, much to the chagrin of Police Chief Jesse Curry.
I had a request, and I have it here, where Mr. Wade requested that you turn all of the evidence obtained in the investigation of Lee Oswald's assassination of the president over to the FBI for mailing to Washington. We're turning all of our physical evidence over to the FBI.
This was on the direct orders of the head of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover.
Here you have the greatest police agency in the world. They're supposed to keep the president alive. He's killed in broad daylight on the streets of a modern American city. How can Hoover possibly admit that he couldn't know about this and he couldn't prevent it? There was only one way, by having a nut who was all alone do it. There was nobody to squeal on. So from the beginning, J. Edgar Hoover had an instant vision. Oswald was a lone nut assassin, and that's all that anybody ever considered, anybody in official position. You can say, let me try and understand what the government did, how it worked this way. You can understand that maybe for a couple of days, they didn't want the truth to come out because they didn't know what was going to happen. They didn't want to frighten people. They wanted to preserve domestic tranquility. Was it going to be an attack on Lyndon Johnson or the Secretary of State? Was it going to be an invasion from abroad? Was this the beginning of a revolution? Those kind of things have to enter the thoughts of the people in authority in Washington. After a couple of days, when everybody knew this wasn't happening, then there's no excuse for the lying.
The lie was that Oswald, a poor shot, fired his three bullets from the sixth-floor window of the book depository in under 7 seconds. No expert marksman has ever achieved this feat. The Warren Commission, basing its findings on the earlier FBI report, at first said two bullets had hit Kennedy, one in the back, one in the head, and one bullet had hit Governor Connally. Their conclusions were thrown into disarray by eyewitness James Tague.
I'm standing right at the east end of the triple underpass on the sidewalk between Main and Commerce. And when the first shot, which I thought was a firecracker, happened and I heard two more, I ducked behind the triple underpass and actually did not see too much of what was going on until I looked out and the presidential limousine was going right by me under the underpass. At that time, Deputy Sheriff Buddy Walters said, "You have blood on your cheek." I reached up, and there was a couple drops of blood. And at that time, I remembered something had stung me during the shooting. He says, "Where were you standing?" We walked back, and from about 40 feet away, we noticed a mark on the curb, a very fresh mark.
The FBI sends some agents from Dallas, and they file a report. It says there's no mark there. It must have been eradicated by the brushes using to sweep the streets. You know, there'd be no streets left in the world if that happened, but it was accepted. But this wasn't even in the street, it was on the curbstone. So, of course, they couldn't get away with that. So the commission got after the FBI and they sent Lindahl Shaney-Felt, a photographic expert, down. and accompanied by Robert Gemberling, who was the case agent in Dallas on the assassination. They went, they got the pictures, they spoke to the photographers, they went exactly to where a point was, and there it was. Except that it was a little bit different. Instead of a hole, you can see the difference in color, you can see the difference in texture, and I know because I've examined it at the archives. It's darker and smoother. Instead of a bullet hole or a nick made by a bullet, you've got it all smoothed over in darker color. So they dig it up, they take it back to Washington, they go through this incredible charade of making a scraping samples off and making a spectrographic analysis of what they know is not the evidence. They don't give a damn about the fact that underneath it is something that could have been a consequence if it hadn't been covered over. They have no questions about why would somebody want to hide this when a president is killed. And then they destroyed the spectrographic plate when I asked for it. At least they say they did. And the court said they'd produce it. They said it doesn't exist. The explanation? Not under oath, understand, just a possible explanation. It must have done it to save space. A 32nd of an inch in the world's largest collection of files, which the FBI has, they're saving space with 1/32nd of an inch, but they get away with this in court.
They did not want a missed shot. It would not fit. And my testimony would prove that there was one missed shot that went over the limousine and hit the curb beside where I was standing. It did change the outcome of the warrant report.
So late in the day, the commission were left with only two bullets to cause all the wounds to both Kennedy and Connolly, and one of those bullets had to have injured both men. To explain this, Arlen Specter, a counselor to the commission, created the single bullet theory, known to critics as the magic bullet.
The infamous magic bullet. We have that bullet exiting from President Kennedy's neck, moving forward and leftward and downward. It now stops in midair, it turns to the right, it comes back a full 18 inches, stops again, and then slams into John Connolly's back. It continues downward, and it goes through his wrist, and somehow they get that right wrist over to the left thigh. If you look at the Zapruder film, you'll see in the individual frames that John Connolly's right wrist is not near John Connolly's left thigh. The significance of this, the importance, cannot be exaggerated. It is impossible to overstate it. Why? Because the single bullet theory is the sine qua non of the Warren Commission report. It's not a matter of how much weight and credibility do you give to it. It's a matter of whether or not you have a single bullet theory that permits you to conclude that there was only one person firing, whether it was Oswald or anybody else in the world. If you don't have a single bullet theory, then you cannot have a sole assassin. And if you move to that point, then you're into conspiracy by definition. And that's why it had to stop with Oswald as a sole assassin. And that's why they came up with the single bullet theory. There's no question in my mind that that 26-volume set should be taken from the shelves of all the libraries where they now rest in the United States from nonfiction and placed in the fiction shelves along with Tom Sawyer, Huckleberry Finn, and Gulliver's Travels. That's where they belong.
Writer Steve Revell's lone pursuit of Kennedy's killers began 4 years ago. His first breakthrough came when he was given the name of a French drug smuggler in prison in the United States, who, it was rumored, had some first-hand knowledge of the president's assassination.
The initial turning point was the first meeting that I had with the French narcotics trafficker at Leavenworth Penitentiary. His name was Christian David. He had been a member of the old French Connection heroin network. He had then been a leader of the Corsican drug trafficking network in South America, known as the Latin Connection. And he had also been an intelligence agent for a number of intelligence services around the world. In exchange for my help in finding him an attorney to represent him against the possibility of his deportation to France after he finished his sentence at Leavenworth, he agreed to give me a certain amount of information concerning the assassination based upon his own knowledge. The first thing that he told me, very reluctantly, and only after 4 or 5 hours of my arguing with him, was that he was aware that there had been a conspiracy to murder the president. And indeed, in May or June of 1963 in Marseille, he had been offered the contract to kill President Kennedy. That was the initial breakthrough, if you will. He was eventually deported to France. I remained in contact with him. I went to Paris to interview him in two prisons in Paris. And in the fear that he would be either committed to an asylum or that he would be convicted of an old murder charge, he gradually gave me additional information about the assassination. His position was that there were three killers and that they had been hired on a contract which had been placed with the leader of the Corsican Mafia of Marseille, a man named Antoine Guérini. Guérini, he said, was asked to supply three assassins, high-quality, experienced killers, to murder the president. And that Guérini did so. In the course of one of the first significant conversations I had with David on this subject, he told me that he had been in Marseille in May or June of 1963, and that every evening he went to Antoine Guérini's club on the old port of Marseille to meet people who owed him money. One evening, Guérini sent for him, asked him to come to his office, which was above the club. Guérini told him that he had an important contract, and he asked David if he were interested. David said, who's the contract on? Guérini said, an American politician. David asked, well, is it a congressman, a senator? And Guérini said, higher than that. La plus haute légume, he said, the highest vegetable. At that point, of course, David knew who he was talking about. David asked him where was the contract to be carried out, and when Guérini said it would be done inside the United States, David refused on the grounds that that was much too dangerous. Now, David initially would only give me the first name of one of the three men on the grounds that two of the three were still alive, and since they were members of this Corsican milieu, which has a code of silence and a code of vendetta, if he named them, he himself would be murdered. However, he did agree to give me the first name of the third man who he said was dead. And that man, he said, was named Lucien. I then spent a great deal of time in Paris and Marseille trying to find out who this Lucien was. And through contacts that I made in the journalistic and police and intelligence communities, I was able to determine that this Lucien was, in fact, a Corsican drug trafficker and killer of the 1960s and 70s by the name of Lucien Sarti. Sarti had been killed in Mexico City in 1972. I confronted David with the name of Sarti, and he in effect confirmed that that was the man he had referred to. He was an extremely reckless, very daring man, known and despised even by his colleagues for taking enormous chances. But that same recklessness made him one of the most successful contract killers and drug traffickers of his era.
Having identified Sarti, Christian David, fearing for his life, refused to name the other two assassins recruited to kill Kennedy. Nonetheless, in successive interviews, he slowly began to reveal how the contract, placed here in Marseille, had been carried out.
In the fall of 1963, the three killers were flown from Marseille to Mexico City, where they spent some 3 or 4 weeks at the house of a contact in Mexico City. He said that they were then driven from Mexico City to the U.S. border at Brownsville, Texas. They crossed the border using Italian passports. He said that they were picked up on the American side of the border at Brownsville by a representative of the Chicago Mafia, with whom they conversed in Italian. They were then driven to Dallas and put up in a safe house, which had been prepared for them so as not to leave any hotel records. He said that they spent several days taking photographs of Dealey Plaza. And in the evenings at the safe house, they studied the photographs and they arranged what he called a crossfire with three guns. On the question of the actual murder, he was reasonably specific that two of the assassins were in buildings behind the president's limousine. He did not know which buildings. However, he did specify that one was high and one was low. In fact, he said presque sur l'horizontal, almost on the horizontal. And he went on to add, you can't understand the wounds unless you understand that one of the men was almost on the horizontal. Now, in a separate conversation with David, I asked him, based upon what I knew about Sarti's penchant for changing his appearance, whether Sarti had ever said anything to him about having worn a disguise. And David said, what do you mean by a disguise? I asked him, did Sarti ever indicate that he wore clothing other than he normally would have worn? And David thought about it for a moment and said, he wore a uniform. I asked him what kind of uniform, and he refused to answer. But he did add that on jobs like this, they were always in disguise. He said, if, for example, there were a military post nearby, they would dress in military uniforms. He said that there were four shots. The first shot was fired from the rear, struck the president in the back. The second shot was also fired from the rear, and as David said, hit the other man in the car. The third shot was fired by Sarti from the front, struck the president in the head. And the fourth shot was fired from the rear and missed the automobile entirely. So his scenario, as he claims to have learned it from the gunman, was three guns, four shots, three hits, one miss. He also added at one point that two of the shots were fired almost simultaneously. He said that in the moment of panic, which always follows an incident of this kind, they were able to get away from Dealey Plaza and go back to the safe house. Now, he made the specific point that the worst thing that you can do at a moment like that is to try to escape. And so they stayed in their safe house for some 10 days until things quieted down sufficiently, and then they were flown by a private plane from Dallas to Montreal. He said that the people who met them in Montreal were established contacts who were used to moving people in and out of the country, and that from Montreal they returned to Marseille. Now, having told me all of this, I presented to him the obvious problem, which was his personal lack of credibility. And I asked him, was there anybody in the world who could substantiate this story? And it was at that point, after thinking about it for a minute, that he advised me to go and look for a man named Michel.
Michel Nicoli could have been anywhere in the world. A former narcotics trafficker turned government informant, he had become a United States federally protected witness and had officially disappeared.
I searched for him in Europe, North America, Central America, and South America. I traveled many, many thousands of miles, spoke to hundreds and hundreds of people. I was given a lot of false leads. I took out coded ads in newspapers all over the world addressed to him, using language that he would understand. And finally, in June of 1986, I almost by accident found the one person in the US government who knew where he was, who was a very high official of the Drug Enforcement Administration. I was able to persuade this man to put me in touch with him without telling him why I wanted to talk to Michel, and he agreed to do so. My DEA contact at one point said to me that in the 30 years that he had been in the business, Michel was the best witness he'd ever had. He had never given the government false or misleading information, and if he said something was true, as my friend said, you could go to the bank on it. Another DEA official whom I spoke to in Marseille, who has known Michel as a witness, said he's always been, in his words, a dynamite witness.
Have you had any contact whatever with Christian David recently?
No, I haven't.
For how long?
Not since, since we were in Brazil together. I caught sight of him in prison. But only in passing, that's all. We haven't been in touch.
So that's how long it's been since you have had any contact with him.
In 1972, we came back from Brazil together. I met him in prison. Or rather, I caught a glimpse of him in the criminal court. That's all. I just caught sight of him. That's all. Since then, I haven't seen him.
In the course of three subsequent conversations, among other things, Michel confirmed that Lucien Sarti was one of the three killers. And I went through with him the details that David had given me. He confirmed all of the details with the exception of two, in which case he said he did not know those specifics. But he did say that he had learned the details from the same source at the same time as David had.
When we met in a bar in Argentina in 1966, I think. Christian David was present. There were five or six of us. I can't remember exactly.
The final pieces of the puzzle were falling into place. From the lips of Michel Nicoli, Steve now had the names of the other two assassins. He now sought to confirm their participation from his first informant, still awaiting trial in his prison cell in Paris.
At that point, I then went back to David. I gave him all three names, and in effect, he confirmed them. When I showed David an aerial photograph of Dealey Plaza, the first thing he said was, "Show me where the railroad bridge is." I pointed out the bridge over Elm Street, and he said that was where Sartee wanted to be. But on the morning of the assassination, the bridge was guarded, and he was forced, as he said, to move on to the little hill with the wooden fence. He took up a position from behind the wooden fence from which he fired one shot, and David specified that he used an explosive bullet. Now, he said that Sartee was the only one who used that kind of ammunition, a remark which he refused to explain and which I didn't understand at the time, until I put the question to Michelle. When I asked Michelle if it were true that Sartee had used an exploding bullet, Michelle sighed and said, yes, that was what I had heard.
Yes, it's Lucien Sartee. Me too. I sometimes carried them with me, but I didn't use them.
What was the advantage of having bullets like that?
It makes a larger hole in the body. And when the bullet flattens out, there aren't any traces, no marks, nothing.
On the question of payment, Michelle agreed with David that the assassins had been paid in heroin, and he went a bit farther. In my first conversation with him, he indicated that although he did not know it at the time, it was he who converted the heroin payment into cash for the assassins. He indicated, at least initially, that the three men had appeared at his apartment in Buenos Aires in the months following the assassination with, as he put it, a substantial quantity of heroin. He was surprised because, to his knowledge, it was the first time that any of the three of them had dealt in heroin. But given his reputation for not asking embarrassing questions, he simply agreed to convert the heroin into cash for them.
Did they ever give you any indication about who was behind this contract?
No, they didn't talk to me about that. It was Christian David who told me that it was someone in the Mafia, but I don't know who it was.
But it was known more or less generally in this circle of Frenchmen in South America that it was the Mafia that was behind it.
Yes.
My own conviction at this point is that the contract probably originated with Carlos Marcello of New Orleans, who placed it in Marseille through his colleague, Santos Trafficante Jr., who had the closest relations with Antoine Guérini. Beyond that, it seems reasonable that Giancana of Chicago was involved, if we accept David and Michelle's idea that the assassins were met at the border by representatives of the Chicago Mafia. And the fact that Sartee's customers were primarily in New York, and the fact that the assassins evidently moved out of the United States through the Montreal corridor, which was very closely linked to the New York Mafia, also suggests that Gambino may have been involved.
In your view, why would they go so far to find assassins for such a job?
In my opinion, to obliterate any traces, to fool the government. Yes, it's more difficult to find foreign killers. It's more difficult, in my view.
The Mafia had to hire white men for the job, since it was to take place in the American South, which meant that they could not go to the other two centers where one found assassins at that time, namely Beirut and Hong Kong. Secondly, they needed highly experienced, skilled assassins. Thirdly, they needed assassins who, if they were caught, could not directly be tied to the American Mafia, and also who were not known to the American police. And fourthly, once again, if they were caught, assassins who could be counted on not to talk.
When someone has a contract to kill someone, he's not rubbing out the name, he's rubbing out the person. You just have to kill him, that's all. And according to who it is, you get paid more. According to who it is, and that's all.
But after all, it was the President of the United States they were talking about.
If they did it, it's because they didn't give a damn. There are people like David who refused to do it. There were others who didn't refuse.
But Sertie, would he have been capable of that?
Oh, yes. As a killer, he's capable of anything. It's not a question of sentiment. No sentiment with him.
I couldn't pursue the matter much farther on my own. I mean, to this point, I had been working on it for 3 years, essentially, on my own. It was clear that at this point, I was going to need some sort of official assistance. And so I decided to confide what I knew in the DEA official who had put me in touch with Michelle. Based upon what Michelle had said and his own inquiries, the DEA official decided that the matter ought to be handled in an official fashion. The first step was that he and I together went to interview Michelle. And to my enormous relief, Michelle repeated essentially the same story he had told me in front of the DEA official. At that point, I, in effect, had engaged some official interest on the part of the government in my inquiries. The DEA official then felt that it was necessary to make the FBI aware of what it was we had learned, since the case was not in DEA's jurisdiction, but was still in the FBI's jurisdiction.
The essence of what I learned was turned over to the FBI by the DEA in 1987. An official of the FBI then interviewed Michel Nicoli and indicated that he was persuaded by Nicoli's statement. I assumed at that point that given the testimony by credible witnesses, the government would then move toward the indictment and the arrest of the people who had been named. So far as I can tell, since then, nothing has happened. Subsequent to that, I was able to learn from Christian David and other sources that the man who was in charge of the logistics and the organization of this plot was another Marseille gangster, a very important figure, was based here in Marseille for many years, named Paul Mondoloni, who was for many years the liaison between the Guérinese at their headquarters here in on the Old Port and the U.S. Mafia, specifically Santos Trafficante. They established that liaison in Havana when Mondoloni ran the Corsican casinos there, and it was sustained later when the Corsicans were thrown out by Castro and they were forced to move to Montreal and establish a heroin smuggling outpost there. Mondoloni would have been the ideal person to have organized and carried out this plot. The feeling on the part of the officials, both at DEA and FBI, however, was that before we could go to a grand jury, we would need two witnesses. We had potentially Michel Nicoli. They felt we would also have to have Christian David. However, Christian David has steadfastly refused to testify on this case until he is freed from jail. He obviously fears for his life. Now, all this is very frustrating. I mean, it's a very intolerable state of affairs because the men who murdered the President of the United States have been named by witnesses who even the government considers are credible. We have people we can put our hands on, people we can arrest, and nothing is being done about it. And yet until they're arrested and interrogated and the truth comes from their own lips, if they are in fact guilty, we may never know the resolution of this mystery. We may never have the truth about this matter. And that's a situation that I personally find intolerable.
Christian David is still in Paris on the old murder charge, the shooting of a French policeman in 1966. He vehemently protests his innocence. His defense lawyer, Henri Jeremy, has great faith in the credibility of his client and his extensive inside knowledge of the criminal underworld.
David is not anybody. He's a serious man. And American authorities knows that David is a serious man. David has been a long time in jail during his life, but anyway, he has made a lot of things during his life. Then when David says something, it's serious.
But David has always been extremely reluctant to impart any details of what he knows about the killing of Kennedy, even to his own lawyer.
He said, yes, I know certain things. Could you tell me those things? I asked him. He told me, no, I'll talk when I'll be free. Yes, but he told me, I can, if you want, write to you what I know. I said, all right. And then he wrote to me a letter, a closed letter. And on this letter, it's written, Cette lettre doit être gardée en dépôt par mon avocat jusqu'à ce que j'ai retrouvé ma liberté. Elle ne peut pas être ouverte sans mon autorisation. That letter must be kept in deposit by my lawyer until I am free. It's impossible to open it without my authorization. There is two signature, Christian David, Christian David. I think there is in this envelope details important to find murderers, because I think there were murderers, and not only one murderer. That's what it is in this envelope. That's what I think about that.
With the new evidence that has emerged from these investigations, so many of the mysteries surrounding the murder of the president can at last be explained. Not least of all, the manipulation of the medical evidence to conceal the devastating effects of the dum-dum bullet fired from the right front by Lucien Sarti. The use of such a distinctive missile and its trajectory would have been immediately apparent at a normal autopsy, as Dr. Cyril Wecht explains.
A frangible bullet is one that is constructed to literally break apart upon impact. Some people call it an exploding missile, some people call it a dum-dum, but they're not quite the same. I think the more correct technical word would be a frangible bullet. If a frangible bullet had been fired from the right side, then it would have, of course, dispersed into dozens, if not hundreds, of fragments, leaving no significant piece of itself intact. There were many small pieces of metal that were never subjected to neutron activation analysis testing. And unless that was done, you see, we could never know for sure whether all of the fragments came from one particular bullet or one batch of bullets. That's the significance of the brain examination relating to whether there was a second gunman and also the possibility of whether a frangible bullet had been used by that second gunman firing from the right side.
I've become convinced that Oswald had nothing to do with the assassination and that he was very carefully chosen and very carefully set up to take the blame. Based upon what I've learned, it seems to me that all the principals involved in the plot to kill the president had ties of one kind or another with U.S. intelligence agencies. There was Trafficante and Giancana, who had been conspiring with the CIA to assassinate Fidel Castro. Antoine Guérini, who had had a relationship with both the OSS and the CIA dating from 1943. And there was Oswald, whom I'm satisfied had been used as a low-level intelligence operative. So even though I don't think that the CIA, for example, had anything directly to do with the assassination, on the day after the assassination, they found themselves in a horribly compromised position, a position in which they could very easily have been blackmailed by the plotters into covering up whatever they knew about the assassination.
But the Mafia could hardly have acted alone, given the intricacy of the assassination plot and the strength of the cover-up for 25 years. Colonel Fletcher Prouty was Chief of Special Operations of the Joint Chiefs of Staff during Kennedy's presidency. He believes even more powerful forces were ultimately responsible.
I think without any question, it's what we call the use of hired gunmen. And this isn't new. In fact, this little manual here, which is called the Assassination Manual for Latin America, contains a line which says that, talking about Latin America, if possible, professional criminals will be hired to carry out specific selective jobs, jobs in quote, which means murders. Well, if this manual for Latin America, printed within the last few years, and a government manual, says that, there's no question but what the application of the same techniques was dated back in Kennedy's time. In fact, I know that from my own experience. You know, I was in that business in those days. So, with that knowledge, you begin to realize that hired criminals, the way this book says, can be hired by anybody in power with sufficient money to pay them, but more importantly, with sufficient power to operate the cover-up ever after. Because you see, it's one thing to kill somebody. It's another thing to cover up the fact that you did it or that you hired somebody to do it. And that's more difficult. So they used the device of the Warren Commission report to cover up their hired killers. Now, who would hire the killers? And who has the power to put the Warren Commission report out over the top of the whole story? You see, you're dealing with a very high echelon of power. It doesn't necessarily reside in any government. It doesn't necessarily reside in any single corporate institution, but it seems to reside in a blend of the two. Otherwise, how could you have gotten people like the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court to participate in the cover-up, the police in Dallas to participate in the cover-up, et cetera, and the media? You know, all the media, not just one or two newspapers, but none of them will print the story that other than Oswald killed the president with three bullets, something that's absolutely untrue.
The people who I think had most to gain, as they saw it, were the military-industrial intelligence complex. It's a myth that the intelligence agents don't make policy. They make it all the time. They always say they're carrying out policy, and sometimes they are. The people who had most to gain were those who didn't want the peace in the world that John Kennedy had tried to turn the world toward when he and Khrushchev worked out the solution to the Cuban Missile Crisis. The people who didn't want John Kennedy to be president were those who were making incredible fortunes from war production.
Had Kennedy lived, I think we'd have had no Vietnam War with all of its traumatic and divisive influences in America. I think we would have escaped that. I think the world would have escaped the 50,000 odd Americans dead and 300,000 more wounded and over 500,000 more hooked on dangerous drugs and tropical diseases. The divisiveness of that war that so many of the people thought unjustified and unnecessary and it shouldn't have been there. It split this country widely, and many of those things have lingered on since.
Kennedy made a speech at American University in June of the year before he died, and he said, we live in one world, we got to breathe in the same air, and we got to live together, we're going to die together. He was very disturbed by our involvement in Vietnam, which he inherited. And there came a time when he called his generals in and spoke to them, and after he spoke to them, the Pentagon issued a small statement saying that we have re-evaluated our involvement in Vietnam and find that we can begin to withdraw our men. The plan was to begin by withdrawing 1,000 a month. 17,000 were to be withdrawn by the time of the election, which was a year later. One plane load reached the United States when John Kennedy was killed. 3 days after the assassination, the body wasn't yet in the ground. The Pentagon issued what it called a re-evaluation of its re-evaluation. And they said simply that we found that our re-evaluation was optimistic. And the rest is history. The whole world turned around on it. The world will not, within the lifetime of anybody living today, recover from just that.
I would like to see a real murder investigation conducted. I would like to see FBI agents and other law enforcement people going to individuals who are involved in the chain of custody, find out where the brain is, find out where the codachromes of the interior chest wounds are, find out where the microscopic tissue slides are. I would like to see all of the evidence brought together and a thorough scientific analysis undertaken. I would also like to see repeat experiments done shooting a Maniker Kirkano with 6.5 millimeter military type ammunition through goat carcasses and human cadavers to simulate the bony fractures in Governor John Connally. And let's see what those bullets look like. Those things can be done. If they are done, then I am convinced that the Warren Commission report will crumble like a house of cards. And of course, the people on the other side, they're not stupid. They are also convinced that that is what would happen, and that is exactly why such a new investigation is not being undertaken.
But the questioning voice of the American people refuses to be silenced. Each year on the anniversary of the assassination, a dedicated band of disbelievers meet on the grassy knoll in Dealey Plaza, typical of those millions of Americans who've refused to swallow their government's official line. Through their diverse efforts and their persistence, critics such as these have kept the quest for the truth alive.